My name's Linny Meakins, and I'm a friend of Mark Stroman, who's on death row in Texas. Please forgive me if I fall over the words of this speech. Speaking in public is not something that I'm used to doing in my everyday life, as you can imagine. I'll do my best though. I thought long and hard as to what to say to you all today, and I said to my closest friend recently that I was going to say just what Mark wanted me to say about him as his PR, which was a job he asked me to do for him back in March 2011. It's in February of 2011 that I walked into my old mum's bungalow and I found her crying. Mark's beloved Madge, which had become known worldwide, had received a letter from her wonderful friend to say that he'd had his execution date. She had, with Mark's support and love, through the hundreds of letters he'd sent over the years, she'd finally managed to overcome the severe depression that she'd had since my father died in 2004. Mark had single-handedly succeeded, where both my family and the doctors had failed, to lift her spirits with his support and the love and kindness that he sent in those words that he wrote in those letters. They'd tease each other about things that made each other laugh and confided their own innermost fears and feelings to each other, and Mark would give Mum good solid advice about things she obviously felt that she couldn't talk to us about her family. Mum had only been in that house 5 weeks previously because she'd been in a care home since my father had died because her wheels had fell off, bless her, suffering with a depression, and she couldn't live alone anymore. She refused to feed herself and everything. Such was the severity of the depression. But I've got to say, Mark made the last few years of her life happy ones, and I am eternally in his debt forever for that fact. Mum had been waiting for his letter to come that morning, like we did every morning, and I'd sit and have my cup of tea with her, waiting for Jenny, our postman lady, to arrive. And I'll quote what she said word to word when she read what he said about he'd received his date. She said, "If they kill him, our Linda, they might as well take me." I was shocked and frightened, both Mark and my mum, because she'd been doing so well in that little house, and we was all so thrilled that she'd got herself, you know, back on her feet and back into an ordinary life again. I'd never heard of reprieve until that moment, and it was for sure a defining moment in my life. I've learnt so much from them, and now knowing these things, I cannot ever return.
Communicate
information from countless personal letters from Mark, as well as the many letters he was sending my dear old mum, liaising with reprieved representatives and solicitors that were visiting him, plus the contact from his friends from all over the world, I learned so much more about Mark as a person. And like everyone else whose lives have been touched by his contact with them, I grew to love and respect him. I felt a new energy flow through me in everything I did, a new purpose took over me, a new focus to try and stop this amazing man being executed, and in some small way, to assist reprieve in putting a stop to the death penalty. During that time, I assisted them in any way they asked of me with their fight with Lundbeck regarding the drugs they supplied for the executions. Even my dear old mum did her part when we were both filmed for an official appeal by reprieve to take action against Lundbeck, a fight that was won, which most of you I'm sure will know. Because of my growing bond with Mark, it was much more difficult to remain professional in my role as his PR. Now, not only was I doing this as a way of repaying my debt of gratitude to Mark for supporting my mum, I'd come to realise firsthand what an amazing and unique person he was, with his heart that was bigger than Texas itself, and his wish to make amends for his wrongdoings, and his desire to try to bring peace to this world by using his own life experiences as a lesson. Mark Stroman was an amazing communicator. He had tremendous potential to help with issues such as prisoner reform, particularly with the younger offenders, who better than Mark, who had walked that walk to its worst outcome, found his peace with his God and come out to the other side, back into the sunshine. Mark Stroman was a genuine article for reform. As I said, it was no longer easy for me to remain impartial. I felt like I had a huge sword in each hand, and every time some media person or hater said something bad about him, I literally wanted to carve pieces off them and humiliate them publicly in my writing with the words that I wrote, showing them no mercy, just as they wasn't showing him any mercy. Quite surprising in light of Mark's request of me was to have his story used as a guiding beacon for peace and to unify all people. But I was growing increasingly angry and bitter at the haters' ignorance and the incompetence and arrogance of the Texas Justice Department, particularly the Governor, Rick Perry. Mark Stroman was a completely changed man, and he had been for several years. In May of last year, he was told of Race Boyen's quest to save him, brought about by racist Muslim faith. Mark was truly moved and humbled by the show of human compassion and forgiveness, and we talked of the huge opportunity this would represent if Mark was allowed to live and join forces with Race to spread the message for peace between religions. The murderer and the surviving victim uniting in a quest for world peace, probably the most powerful and meaningful message for peace since the times of Martin Luther King and John Lennon. And Mark wanted so much to join Race in this quest. Race Boyen, for those who don't know, was the Bangladeshi man who Mark shot and wounded after the 9/11 atrocities. In the height of the aftermath of 9/11, there were 1,271 hate crimes against Muslims in Texas, actually the result of the USA government propaganda machine whipping up public support against the Muslims to try to support them so they could invade Iraq and steal their oil. Now, I'm not political at all, but I'm sorry, that was just blatant. It was blatant. It did backfire on them, however, as ordinary citizens then started taking their own actions against Muslims living in their country, and it was Texas after all. Now, the government had to make an example of zero tolerance for this behaviour, which of course I realise myself is unacceptable, but Mark was chosen as this political example. He was a political pawn. The fact that he had reformed during his 10 years incarceration wasn't a consideration. Mark Stroman was always going to be executed. What the USA government had backed on, however, was Race Boyen's own high-profile campaign to try to save Mark Stroman. Whereas Mark's name was known mainly in America, the Race Boyen and Mark Stroman story for peace, unity and forgiveness went global. Even some governments from Europe were asking for clemency for Mark. This was not on the neatly planned agenda of the USA government or the Texas Justice Department. government uses war to gain assets. They need their people in support, not considering peaceful alternatives, unity or forgiveness. It was an unexpected and unwanted spanner in their works. I personally wrote to President Obama asking for clemency for Mark and got a letter back. It was shameful, it really was, and the fact that I got it back 5 days after Mark's death, I found that I was completely stunned at the lack of their compassion for my loss. As we all know, the death penalty is a cruel, barbaric and outdated punishment. The execution process itself is unacceptable. The 3-drug cocktail used to kill the prisoners had had no recognised testing. The drugs are administered by prison wardens, not by the doctors, as they are prevented by law from killing people, and quite rightly so. There are even written affidavits from witnesses that state some prisoners have died in agony. Still, the USA judicial system does nothing to stop this. The death penalty does not recognise any kind of reform of a prisoner, even when there is clear evidence that can be substantiated. The death penalty is not foolproof. It does not only punish those who commit the crimes. Through negligence of attorneys and loopholes in the USA judicial system, there are innocent people who are currently sitting awaiting execution on death row. The death penalty does not give the ultimate punishment only to those. Because of the law of parties, it is able to give this punishment to innocent people, people that did not commit any crime, but hey, they knew the person that did. These two people are deemed guilty by association and are also executed, and done so without remorse or compassion. The death penalty punishes the families and loved ones of the people they execute. For the years their loved ones are sitting on death row waiting to die, and for the long, long years that follow the death. Mark's best friend on death row was Gregory Wright. We've got Gregory over here. I believe Linda put it on there. I know his wonderful wife, Connie, came to England to speak to you all here. She had to watch her darling husband die, knowing he was innocent. I spoke to Connie some time before Mark's execution, and she wanted me to see the video made of her speech to you all, where she described that dreadful day in detail. A day that no person should ever have to endure, to watch their loved one strapped to the gurney and put to death. I have never been so moved in my life as I was while watching the film she sent me. One of Greg's last requests was that Connie visited Mark when Greg had gone. And Connie had been doing that for several years, and a great bond had grown between her and Mark. And this remarkable woman once more had to witness the execution of another person she loved, Mark this time. 3 weeks ago I had the privilege of meeting dear Connie when Mark's closest friends met together at the Grand Canyon in Arizona. We paid one last tribute to our friend and spread his ashes to the wind, wild and free, as Mark was born and is now once more. I know I would take this tragic experience to my own life's end. My mum, Mark's beloved Madge, couldn't withstand the pain of his death and died exactly 8 weeks to the day. The morning of her death, she said to me, "I'm afraid, Linda." And I said to her, "What of, darling?" And she said, "Of dying alone." She pointed at Mark's picture and she said, "He said we would walk up that hill together, but he's gone without me." I held her hand and I said gently, "Mum, he will come back for you and walk with you." She was another innocent victim of the death penalty, as was his 4 children and us, his closest friends. Thank you so much for listening, everybody, and thank you for turning out in this awful weather. Please, I would ask you to consider, when you have a little spare cash in some way, to donate a few quid online if you are able to Reprieve, as they do such fantastic work for prisons on death rows worldwide, and it enables them to continue as they rely solely on our donations. Thank you.